Li Min. Okay. And I'm an archaeologist at UCLA, specializing in early China. I'm speaking on behalf of Professor Barry, the director of Center of Chinese Studies, to welcome everybody to this special event to celebrate Professor Miao Zhe's new book, From Lingguang Dian to Wu Liang Ci, a very important contribution to Chinese art history. So today's format will be more like a conversation. We have assembled a distinguished list of panelists, most specialists in early Chinese history or archaeology, art history. And I will introduce all of them first, and then we will have Li Jing, a senior editor at Sanlian Weekly Journal, to have a brief interview with Professor Miao Zhe about his career, his inspiration, about this book, and also as a person, as a scholar. And then after that, we will have each panelist start with most junior scholar to most senior ones to offer comment, observations, critiques to this book and questions that Miao Zhe would respond to. And of course, during these conversations, other panelists are welcome to contribute. So we would have a lively conversation about this work that actually find the origin in Professor Miao's visit to Los Angeles on Getty Fellowship. So if you open the book, see here, quite substantial piece. And if you see on the first page, he would describe to us that the inspiration for this book starts from his UCLA visit. So that's why we have this special privilege to host this special event. And now I will briefly introduce all the panelists, starting with Professor Cai Liang from Notre Dame University. She's an intellectual historian of early imperial China. And Professor Lai Guolong from University of Florida, a graduate at UCLA Art History Department. Again, art historian, archaeologist of early imperial China. And here we have Professor Li Huishu from UCLA Art History Department, a specialist in middle period imperial art and also Chinese gardens, gender studies. Also, our new faculty, Professor Mai Huijun, just joined us last year from Harvard, where she recently graduated in Chinese literature, middle period Chinese literature. Okay, did I miss anybody? And then, of course, Li Jing, a senior editor from Sanlian Weekly Journal, a good friend with the author, and she would provide us this with this interview. And I will turn to Li Jing and Miao Zhe. Go ahead.
好的，那我开始。大家好，我是李晶。 之前呢，我当老朋友，就是也是我的师兄啊，这个尚红科跟我说来参加这样一个活动，我毫不犹豫的答应了，因为我现在实在是觉得我不知深浅啊，然后现在后悔也来不及了。这个我确实觉得这个学识浅薄，在这里面这也不是客套话，但是呢，我稍感安慰的是，后来我听了三联的那一场。 因为有很多专家，他们也在讲，他们在读这本书时候的感觉到的那个，就是有门槛啊，感觉到的这种有敬畏心啊，所以我又释然了，所以我又勇敢的来去迎接这个挑战。那么简单的讲呢，我也知道时间宝贵，但是请允许我稍微再介绍几句我自己的这个想法和心情。 简单的讲呢，就是说，这个我在这里面呢是一个局外人，但是我觉得我尽量代表一个外界的眼光，一个学术圈和艺术圈之外的一个大众的视野，向妙哲老师提一些问题。 再加上呢，我也知道这本书是在三联出的。那么这两位编辑资深的编辑老师孙晓林老师还是冯金恒老师，都是我非常无论在工作上还是在私人交往上都是非常信任和非常尊重的朋友和同行，所以呢就也觉得非常高兴能在这一场啊来，然后能跟妙哲老师能跟大家有一个交流。 那首先呢，因为妙哲老师，我是确实是久闻大名了。之前也看到您的，又有译作，又有这个自己的散文集，所以呢，当这个上鸿科师兄跟我说您要有一个煌煌巨著的时候，我当时第一反应就是这个好像这个跨度非常大。但是呢，当我看了您的书的时候呢，我又想，好像您之前做的所有的工作。 也都是为了这样一本书，我不知道我这样理解的对不对。所以呢，我知道您是早期80年代是在北大毕业的，然后您做过诗人，然后当然我们也熟悉您的散文了，然后这个据说能看到陈寅恪先生的影子啊，评价也非常高，然后呢，您又做翻译，这个翻译也是在业界口碑也非常好的。我是想请您谈一谈。 就是您之前，因为您那天在三联的那场也讲了，是50多岁的时候，在三联出了这样一本书。那么您在这之前的这些的做的，无论是翻译也好，还是散文也好，和这本书的关联是什么？其实只有表面的关联，所以你打开这本书，发现它的扉页上引的。 Thomas Brown 的一个题词，然后在第8章里边也引了他的一句题词。那么，所以我自己呢，也在试图理解，就是说这些之间的关联是什么东西。所以这样呢，我就所以引的时候呢，也自己的 struggling 这到底这之间有什么关联？我觉得直接的关联是没有的，唯一的就是说，要说有点一个 common thread 的话，就是对这个文风的一些追求。就是翻译的时候，因为译的都是文学作品，所以需要呈现它的文风。那么我在写作的时候，写这本书的时候呢，包括写论文的时候呢，也就努力就是说把 文风呢写的有点自己的 flavor， 其实，至于更深的关联，我觉得是没有的，就是一贯之间的关联，就是我追求一种个人的一种写作的风格。Okay,
I will provide a quick summary. So this event will be using mixed language. So some will be Chinese, some will be English, but I will try to take care of the English-only audience by providing a very brief summary. So Ms. Li asked how to situate Professor Miao Zhe's work with his other literary explorations. He has translated at least 4 major English literature works. As you can see in the preface citing Thomas Brown's work, and in what way Professor Miao's work connect with these activities, and he's also a distinguished poet too. So he argues that the connection are primarily in terms of a writing style, which is very distinctive for this book. Go ahead.
因为我也想这个大家可能也看出来，这个主要是在 UCLA 主办的这样一次活动，然后参加的都是做艺术史学者的这样的一个范围啊。然后呢，我也是也借这个机会也请您讲一讲，就是因为这次的主场是在有 UCLA 中国中心举办的。 大约是2012年的时候呢，我去 Getty Institute 做访问，那么到了2013年，好像是2013年春天，那么这时候呢，就我做访问的期间呢，就是 Getty 你知道在 Malibu 还有很多西方古代的收藏 ，Greco-Roman 就是希腊罗马的一些收藏，这样我就有机会看了一些。然后 Getty Institute 呢有大量的关于西方古代的书，因为它比较这个领域比较强，包括一些那个 photographer 那个 archive 有大量的档案，这样我也就看了不少书，这样跟里边的几位学者呢，做西方古代的学者也有一些交谈，这些经验呢就是给了我一个机会，就让我从一个比较的视角，就是西方古代提供的一个比较的视角，去理解我当时正在研究的这个汉代山东的古地画像的性质，那么也从而提出了一个比较大胆的一个想法，一个猜测，一个设想，就是我研究的这批东西所折射的呢，可能就是已经消失的汉代已经消失的这个帝国艺术，当时的朝廷的绘画，也就是西方古代研究他们所称的 imperial art 帝国艺术。那么这个概念就是从那次的经验那次访问里面获得的，因为了解这些研究。那么罗泰这是也比较大的一个想法，也比较新的一个想法。那么罗泰教授呢对我这个想法呢就很鼓励，就是所以他就请那个 UCLA 的那个艺术史系还有 Getty， 然后安排了一个报告让我把我这个想法简单的勾勒一下。我记得那个报告呢就设在 UCLA 的那个图书馆里面，请的人还不少，还有已经退休的 Getty 的那个 director Higgins 去了。那么
难忘的一个报告
啊，
难忘的一个报告
对我是最也很难忘。那么在那个之后呢，大约有七八年的时间吧，七八年八九年具体我也忘了，所以我就不断的审查就是那个想法，不断的细化这个想法，去论证修正这个想法，那么最终的结果呢就是今天我们要讨论的这本书，从灵光殿到五梁祠。所以可以说这本 UCLA 是这本书起步的地方，是第一次有了这样的一个 inspiration， 然后由于跟西方古代艺术作品书籍以及学者的接触，然后就刺激了我这样一个比较大胆的一个设想，所以关联是很深的，要谢谢 UCLA， 谢谢 Getty。
Okay, so the question is about the connection with UCLA with the art history community in Los Angeles. Professor Miao argues that states that he got the inspiration for this book during his visit on a Getty fellowship almost 10 years ago in Getty Institute and other institutions in this area.He got a chance to look a lot about Western art and start to think about the connections between imperial art and folk art. So there is bold hypothesis start to emerge and where these engravings in Han early imperial shrine couldpreserve aspect of imperial art, which has vanished. So Professor von Falkenhausen, which I will introduce next, very much encouraged him to explore these ideas. And we also created an opportunity for him to give a very memorable presentation at UCLA, where these ideas were further communicated with the academic community here. Again, so after his return, he has been working on this theme through this decade, and he think UCLA has provided him the source of great inspiration for it. And he's very appreciative of that. How next?
下面把这个时间交给各位专业的学者，然后我就先安心当我的这个围观群众，后面有什么问题我再作为围观群众我再来问，好，请专业学者入场吧，黎明老师您来吧。Okay,
yeah, so we have a brief sketch of the background of this book. Next, I will introduce Professor Lothar von Falkenhausen, distinguished professor of Chinese art history and archaeology at UCLA, kind of a special host for this book project spanning over a decade. So he will talk about his involvement in this process before we each take turns to ask questions.
visual system. deep urge, 就是说很深刻的一种学术性的探索，这个探索早就可以感觉到，哪怕没有找到这些，反正能够帮助他 找那些反正比较资料的西方著作，MIAO Zhe也会做出来了。这本书非常精彩，不是一般的精彩，而且写这本书也比较大胆，因为这个材料并不是没有人研究过的，包括西方，包括中国很多，其实有一些重要的著作，但是这个新书又开辟了一个新的可以去理解这批材比较正确的理解这批材料的一条路子，这个我们应该非常感谢，而且也应该非常佩服MIAO Zhe，恭喜。
Can you give a very brief English summary of what you said?
Yes, I tried to characterize the importance of MIAO Zhe's new book. I doubt that I was intimately involved with its gestation because these are ideas that MIAO Zhe had in his head for a long time. Yes, of course, he consulted some works on Western art history and perhaps got some methodological inspirations from them. But this methodology is something he developed in close communion with the material. And as a result, for the first time, he has overcome the traditional tendency of simply juxtaposing visually observable materials with transmitted textual occurrences, and has reconstructed a visual system in which the material culture and the visual representations that we can observe in them can unfold their full meaning. This is an extremely important achievement, which completely puts into the shade a great deal of important previous scholarship.
Great. Thank you. Now we will basically go to the panelists and start with Professor Mai, the most junior of us all, and then we will return to Professor von Falkenhausen to offer his own questions and also a concluding remark. Before I do that, I just want to say hi to my own teacher in art history of early imperial China, Professor Martin Powers from University of Michigan. Hi, Marty. He's in the audience. Okay, Professor Mai, it's your turn.
Thank you. 谢谢黎明老师和各位前辈让后辈来这个恭临盛会，然后我很期待继续向妙老师请教您的这本著作里面涉及到的一些比较宏大的问题。那我想由我这一位资历最浅的这位这样的一个学生和学者来开始问答，其实也是一件好事，我可以代表更广大的读者从一个比较外围的角度，或者说比较大的概念性的角度，然后来进入妙哲老师的这本书。那我想从比较就是我想也许我们可以从开头开始，也就是拿到妙哲老师这本书我比较第一个印象就是我比较震撼的就是这本书的雄心壮志，就是它其实不光是一本像刚刚罗泰老师描述，它不是一本艺术史内部的话语的深挖的一本书，而是在它的论证以及在它的构建上，它其实涉及了文学史观念史，然后政治史等等一系列的很重要的问题。那我有两个小的问题作为开端，那这两个小的问题呢是涵盖一头一尾的，那主要是从妙哲老师这本书的大题目开始。那您这本书的大题目有两个部分，一部分就是从灵光殿到武陵祠，然后副标题的部分呢，两汉之交帝国艺术的余影。 那我想勾勒出三个关键词。那首先两个关键词作为一对关键词，就是从灵光殿到武陵祠。那这一个跨越就是对，我还忘了说这个，我很钦佩的一点，妙哲老师做的一个贡献或者说一个很有益的尝试，是在他的cross-disciplinarity， 就是跨学科性。那我自己作为一个也比较希望能够做这方面的研究的学者来讲，是深知里面的不易，与他的非常多的一些在材料运用上的一些问题和困难性。所以我想先从这个跨学科的角度来问妙哲老师第一个问题。那从灵光殿到武陵祠，它其实实现了非常多的层面的跨越。首先是从三联这个会议也有老师提到，从生到死的一个跨越，生的艺术到死的艺术。然后但是还有妙哲老师自己在序言里面提到的，从帝国中心到地方，也就是到边缘的一个跨越。他还有从精英到民众的一个跨越。但是他还有在时间上的一个跨越，以及如果我们考虑到灵光殿赋的话，它其实是一个从观者的角度出发，而且是从滞后性的一个观者，那王延寿作为一个后来者，到了汉朝的一个辉煌的遗迹上，他瞻仰这个灵光殿写出的一个赋，它也是这个对于语境上的一个跨越。但是它还有像妙哲老师在序言里面提到很重要的一个维度，就是形式上的一个跨越，就是您比较重点的提出来的一个概念，从纹样到状物的一个跨越。那这个非常多的这个跨越，它其实提出来的问题是很多重的。那我第一个问题也许简单可以概括为为什么我想要请妙哲老师解释一下，为什么您认为用纹样到状物这样的一个可以说是 paradigm shift 这样的一个描述，可以比较恰当的来形容这样一个很重要的你区别出来的这样在这一个历史时代发生的一个变革，也就是所谓Gombrich 所谓的 radical reorientation of perception。 那为什么要用纹样到状物这样的一个其实并非没有问题的，就是很容易会产生一些描述上的一个问题。那我想请你再具体的来去展开解释一下为什么是这样的描述而不是其他可能性的描述，比如说你也很重视的叙事图像的叙事化例如作为一个例子那这就是我想问的第一个问题，就是我也想知道用这样的方式来描述我们得到了什么，失去了什么，强调了什么，抹消了什么，在这个叙事里面。那我第二个问题跟第一个问题其实是紧密相连的，那我就迅速概括一下，就是妙哲老师这本书其实很大程度上是从 production， 就是从艺术的生产者或者说艺术的制造者的这个角度出发去审视这些材料的。那您的标题副标题里面一个很重要的关键词，刚才黎明老师和罗泰老师也都提到的是一个帝国艺术的这样的一个概念。那所谓的帝国艺术这样的一个提法，在我看来它其实强调的是图像和物质新造的公共性。那这点妙哲老师自己在序言里面有很重的强调，它的公共性、修辞性以及它的政治功能。那如果我们将这个类比为一种话术的话，那其实它是要考虑受众的，就是它的听众、它的 viewership 或者 spectatorship。 那这个问题其实关涉到图像或物质工程的阐释语境，就是它的 conceptual framework， 我们如何在特定的历史、社会和政治语境里面去界定或者定义这个图像和新造的意义。那这个 viewership 在妙哲老师这一本书里面似乎不是一个重点去描述的一个对象。那我想请问妙哲老师，在之后的这两本书会不会viewership 或者 spectatorship 会不会作为一个重要的概念去出现？那我再简短的用英文来概括一下我的两个问题。 My first question has to do with Miao Zhe's conceptual framework which could be described as from pattern is that the best way to describe Wenyang, from patterning to representation? So why, I asked Professor Miao, why did he choose to use such a general or generic configuration to describe this so-called revolutionary change in history, in art history at this moment? So my second question has to do with viewership and the absence of spectatorship and the absence of describing how these artworks were viewed or who were the viewers of these artwork in the period that Professor Miao Zhe deals with. Thank you.
Okay, 谢谢慧君。 很好的问题。 文样当然我们可以说是pattern， 也可以说是一个abstract decoration。 那么状物呢，其实 英语里边跟它对应的，我觉得最准确的是pictorial。 那么我用文样到状物确实是有一些想法的，那么这个想法当然就会在第二本书里会谈的比较多一点。那么这跟我们对早期艺术的一个理解比较关系比较大。 我在三联的会议里边谈到呢，就是说，你如果看晚期的艺术，比如说最有代表的就是近现代的西方艺术，你会发现，就是说这种艺术的经验跟其他的经验相对是比较分离的，比较 differentiated separate 的一种经验，所以它内艺术内部的一些理由啊，一些 necessities 呢。 会给他提供各种变革的动力。那么在早期社会，比如古代社会，其实各种经验都是交互在一起的，渗透在一起的，崩塌为一个整体。所以这种艺术的经验呢，是不能跟其他的经验、政治的、社会的、信仰的 politic 就是观念不能分离的。这样呢，就是艺术其实就成了一种什么样的东西呢？就成了一种 集体表达的东西，就 Durkheim 说的那个 collective representation， 就是一种集体的一种再现的东西。所以这就是我对早期艺术的一个理解，就是说它不是纯粹艺术内部的事情，而是一个 collective representation， 就是一个集体表达的问题。那么跟它表达的礼仪、政治、文学、意识形态，还有信仰。 宗教里边的是一致的，那么这样就涉及到，就是说从纹样到状物，如果从这个角度理解呢，其实就变得很有趣。它一方面呢，你看到的是一个艺术的一个现象，就是说它有一个从抽象的设计到 pictorial 这个转变，那么从 collective representation 的角度怎么理解？ 那么，所以我这时候我就用了纹样跟状物，纹样呢是相对来说比较抽象的，状物呢就开始跟现实呢，就你人造的这个 artificial order 就开始努力的跟 reality 有一个 matching， 他们之间的有一个对应。那么我觉得这个体现的呢，就是战国秦汉转变的一个很关键的一点。 就是说，在战国秦汉之前呢，由于人跟事跟物是没有什么间隔的，由于社会结构简单很小，人是直接侵蚀侵物的。到了战国秦汉之后呢，突然间社会结构变大了，由原来的小的那种小的统治区变成大的这种七国，最后变成一个帝国，这样统起码统治者。 跟那个精英跟事物的关系之间就开始变远，这样中间就需要一套 mediated 的一套 knowledge， 来帮助你去跟这个 reality 之间去有一个接触。所以我的第二本书会以一个更大的雄心来谈，就是说 这种 pictorial 其实应该理解为你用人造的这套系统去对应现实，那么这就是整个这个战国秦汉时期所发生的一个 collective representation 集体表现的一个倾向，包括不仅是政治的、观念的、科技的、天文的、术数的，所有这些东西其实都是在努力让我们人造这个系统能给现实匹配得上。那么所以我就用了这个从一个抽象的一个纹样到一个 pictorial， 所以怎么理解 pictorial 的问题，我第一本书里其实谈的不多，那么但是这个想法一直是在背后的，就是如果你把这个艺术现象理解为一个集体再现的问题，那怎么理解这种集体再现 cognitive 方面，就认知方面的这个它的性质到底是什么，所以这是我用这个词的一个想法，一个更深的一个想法。那么第二个问题就是关于是不是有spectatorship 方面的考虑。没有，我觉得因为一本书它的目的总是 limited， 无法就是说什么东西都囊括进去，所以主要是从生产的角度来考虑。那么如果我们从那个观众的角度来考虑呢，汉代的精英艺术跟罗马西方希腊古代不太一样，包括有点像埃及的艺术，它的观众其实是相当有限，就是最精英的那个阶层，朝廷里的官员呀、文士啊等等。像那个希腊罗马它有个 public space， 没有那样的东西，所以这个没有涉及，总之没有关心这个问题，知道是不是回答了你的问题。
谢谢妙哲老师，那我就简短的概括一下妙哲老师的回答。Professor Miao's answer to my first question about why he chose to use the transition from pictorial art to representational art to describe this historical, what he calls conceptual revolution in this period.
Pictorial art to representational art, from decorative art tradition to pictorial tradition.
From decorational tradition to pictorial tradition.
Yeah.
So he begins with discussing, I think, a sense of dissatisfaction with the existing scholarship that oftentimes separate artistic, so the experience of art from other types and aspects of social experience in the society. So the way he enters into this this question is through thinking about how, in what way, the experience of art can tell us about a more general sort of pattern of thinking or mode of seeing or way of thinking in early China. So he believes that the experience of art cannot be separated or cannot be sort of view separately from the experience in other dimensions, other realms of existence. And he sees art as more or less in Durkheim's, the way Durkheim's put it, as a collective expression of the mentality of the society. And he perceives a coherence between the expression in art form and expressions in other forms, such as language and other performative arts. So back to the question of why using the transition from decorative art to pictorial art or representational art, I think the general line of thinking is that for Professor Miao, this transition is actually a transition to approach or getting close to a closer relation or a more direct imitation or representation of the reality of the real world. So if we think about the phenomena that happen in the realm of arts, alongside the changes that happen in social, political, and cultural structure in this transitional period of history, then we would identify a parallel sort of pattern between these two realms. And so in answering my second question about viewership and audience of these art forms, Professor Miao said that there's actually not much space left in his colossal three-volume work that deals with viewership, and also because he thinks that the viewership of early Chinese art is actually more, I guess we could sort of think of it as like a model that's closer to Egyptian burial art rather than the Roman art, which has more or less a public audience. But in the early Chinese case, most of these arts are only available or accessible by a very close coterie of elites. So very limited viewership. Okay.
Okay, before I move to next panelist, anybody wish to jump in on this exchange? You know, further elaborations, critique?
Well, if I can follow up with a very quick question. Sure. I find it really interesting that Professor Miao perceive largely a coherence between the experience of art and other realms of existence, right? For example, what we see in language, what we see in transmitted text. So this actually is one of my the question I initially wanted to ask is because Professor Miao's book actually deals with very different texts that are of very different nature, text and also transmitted text, excavated text, objects and visual materials. So I actually wanted to ask whether or not you perceive an incoherence between these dimensions of these different data rather than the coherent narrative that is put forth in the book. But I see Professor Lai has a question.
Jump in.
Yeah, I just want to add to the discussion, actually, the transition from decorative art to pictorial art is Miao Zhe actually following the previous scholarship. I think the Lao Gan and even Wu Hong already are thinking about that. I think, it's interesting, Lota, do Lota have something to say?
The correct term is ornamental art, not decorative art. Mm-hmm. Decorative art is something else. It should be ornamental.
Ornamental art. So I think even Wu Hong's after he finished the Wu Liangzi book, in one of his articles from Temple to Tomb, there's one note. He talked about of his project at that time was exactly on this question of from bronze jade object to pictorial art. So, but he later on came out with a different product, different result of the monumentality in the book. But that note was not translated into the Chinese translation of Wu Hong's article. But if we look at his 1989 article, there's one long note, and this exactly. So many scholars were thinking about this transition. So, but the Miao Zhe's solution to that question is a completely different one. So I just want to add that.
Yeah, there's a huge lacuna, you know, about the question in the current narrative Chinese art history. So, about the rising and the birth of pictorial art tradition in Chinese art history.
We can talk about from object. Bronze, jade, to three-dimensional object, to one-dimensional pictorial art.
The narrative is object-oriented.
Yeah.
Mm. How? Yeah, I want to jump in a bit too over this transition from what you describe as a qin li qin wei, so in-person interaction, right? The leaders gave instructions to the lieutenant, to the lords. So that's an archaic mode of kind of communication. And then you change to an imperial mode where you have bureaucracy, right? Mm-hmm. So the information are transmitted not on personal face-to-face interactions.
Yeah.
I found this has a striking similarity with what we use to discuss the emergence of human cognition in Upper Paleolithic, Middle Paleolithic, Upper Paleolithic. Yeah, we can map that with the distribution of lithic material. So as the human mind change, the range of material trait network expand. So I find that very interesting. This is what I learned from Professor Bob Whelan at University of Michigan when I was a graduate student. So I find that very inspirational. But at the same time, I want to draw attention to these archaic states like Shang and Zhou, where we have to avoid a tendency to flatten them into something very interpersonal. Because if you look at the Western Zhou inscriptions, they're behaving like an empire if it is placed in a different continent. In China, we reserve that word of empire for Qin and Han, right? But in terms of scope and structure, I gave you example. I put in the chat room already, Yi Hou Gui, before he grants the Lord a new colony, the king actually visited the map room and where the maps of King Cheng and King Wu, so the founding kings, how the attack of Shang territory was mapped out and then inspected the map for Eastern territories before sending out Lord Yi. And then underneath that, you have a very detailed inscription. How many rivers, how many households? So that kind of a behavior already involves a kind of an information processing that's similar to an empire. You almost have to send out census collectors, anthropologists, in order to compile that kind of human terrain information. So as you move to the next book, I want you to give more texture to the pre-imperial era, not to flatten them. Because in that case, you would have flashlight only under the Han period, it was a glorious. And before that is, Tian Bu Sheng Zhong Ni, Wan Gu Chang Ye. Okay, my quick jump in is I see there's a great parallel in his work with our discussion of a transition from Middle Paleolithic to Upper Paleolithic, involving the change in human cognition and their social network and resources trade.
You, mean, you should translate this into Chinese now. You've already said it in English.
Yes, sorry. I totally forgot. 我刚才说的是, this happens a lot. 这个经常发生, 抱歉。 我刚才说的就是说, 我们应该关注, 在帝国时代之前的, 这个早期的国家, 它实际上不是像我们想象的那样, 像一个小小的社会, 大家都互相认识, 都是基于人跟人之间的这种, 信息的交流, 然后到了帝国之后, 你才开始用一些个抽象的, 官僚化的这种信息, 来管理这个帝国, 所以刚才我把西周的这个以后鬼的铭文, 做了一个例子，就是这个王在这个改封夷侯的时候，他先进了这个宫廷里边的这个图史，然后在那里看了这个周武王伐商的地图，然后再看 东国的地图，然后呢再很具体的列出来这个新改封的这个遗地有多少条河流，有多少个有多少人口，我给你多少多少人，就这个是一个很像帝国的行为，但是这个要比这个秦汉帝国要早将近1000年。所以我的意思就是说，我们不应该把这个帝国之前的社会给它特别扁平化，然后这样就像一个手电照到的那个秦汉帝国的时代特别的光辉，之前的时候都一片黑暗。 OK, that's my translation.
我觉得李敏说的很对。那么这个问题其实也是个哲学问题，像 Hegel 还有那个 Cassiel 他们都提过，从 immediacy 到 mediated 这一套东西。那么社会学呢，其实也谈过，像 Norbert Elias 他谈过从那个 involvement 到他叫 detachment， 大家讲 involvement 到 detachment。我觉得这是一定是一个 process， 是一个过程，不会是一个截然不同的两个时代。从就像你说的，从新石器到商周，其实一直在发生一些间接化的这种过程。那么只是强度跟性质可能不一样。你要说周代是一个彻底的 person to person 的这么一个，那你肯定是不对的。一定有他大量的间接的一些手段，也抽象的一些东西去那什么。所以，但我觉得战国秦汉还是有一个很根本的一个变化。所以你说的很对，就是把它扁平化是不好的，应该把它变成一个 process。
OK. So I just quickly translate. So he see that as a process of becoming, evolution.Where in the late Bronze Age, you could have these practices that resemble imperial behaviors. Go ahead, Lothar.
I would add to this that, of course, the pre-Han epoch is not a homogeneous thing, but the kind of ornamental tradition.That you see as sort of the thing that the pictorial turn during the Han was able to overcome or arise in opposition to is something that only came into being in the 9th century BC. And the tradition before then, from the Neolithic to the Shang and to the early Western Zhou, early to middle Western Zhou, was a very different visual system that probably shouldn't be characterized as ornamental. We can talk about this is outside of today's topic, but we should probably historicize this even further.And look at this as a sequence of steps through time. There's something else I was going to say at the end, but maybe it fits here as well. Of course, the Han Dynasty is very remarkable because it not only seems to have achieved, it didn't begin, you point this out yourself, this began in the Warring States period, but it achieved this,pictorial turn, but it also towards the end of the Han Dynasty achieved a turn to something else, which in the West we only get after the Renaissance, namely the shift to expressive art, where art suddenly, the specific way of executing a work of art no longeraims at representing the outside world, but the inner temperament or the inner personality of the artist. That idea, which subtends the Chinese calligraphic tradition, is something that we first see at the end of the Han Dynasty. And of course, it then exists in a very interesting sort of dialectic tension with the pictorial tradition, and also, by the way, with the ornamental tradition, which by no means disappears when the pictorial a trend occurs. So instead of having sort of a replacement of one thing by another, you have a very interesting layering going on. 我简单的翻译一下。 我要提醒大家说，所谓的这个文养性的这么一种视觉系统，其实也是有它的历史性，而且它的开端并不是在很早的时间，是在公元前九世纪左右，在那个之前的，从新世纪时代到西周，早。 早期中期的那段时代的视觉系统又是不同的事情，要另外再考虑。另外一个是，就是说汉代不仅仅完成了像那个装，叫什么这个，装物，装物呀，装物的这个这个这么一个转变，但是它又它到东汉后期又发生了另外一个，至少一样重要的一个过程，也就是说从就是让艺术表现不只是外界，而是这个艺术家本身的内心的这么一种艺术。 这个当然主要是可以在那个时候，主要是在书法艺术所能看到的。但是反正东汉已经往这个方向想过，这一点在西方艺术史上要等到文艺复兴以后，非常这个非常有意思。当然，这么一种转变，并没有代替。 以前所存在的那个庙址所谓的这个装饰和文阳和装物的那两个，而且他们是同时继续存在的，是重叠的，是这个，而且是互相之间有一点定的这个辩证的这个关系。 其实这是从苗哲的这些体会可以完全充血，而且用苗哲的这套方法可以完全充血中国美术史的这个基本的这个发展史，很值得做，没人做过 ，Max Lue 也没有做过，那个巴霍夫也没有做过，他们试图过。 他们那个时候的人还比较天真，他们以为用他们当时的材料可以做，但是没有成功。用我们现在手上的材料，我们可以比较大胆的做出来。好，现在下一个
，So we will move to next one, Professor Cai Liang, early China imperial China intellectual historian. I think this. This, 我们从这个年轻往 senior 的这个学者的这个次序比较好，因为 the later ones can always cut in. So they will have the young scholars will have a more coherent presentation.
I don't know how young I am. Okay, 我已经进了不惑，事实不惑。 Okay, 首先呢，非常荣幸被邀请参加妙哲教授的这场讨论会。 作为一个历史学家呢，我完全是抱着一种学习的态度来阅读妙哲老师的一个巨著。妙哲老师谈到他的这本书呢，基本上我最先知道是2017年在浙江大学为李宁老师开祝寿会的时候，他提到这本书。现在知道呢，实际上这本书的最初形成呢，大概在10年之前，基本上就10年磨一剑。就我阅读的时候非常享受。 而且呢，我也非常就是觉得妙哲老师也真正的达到了作为一种历史学家的一种理想状态，穷尽史料。比如说我自己是做西汉思想史政治史，其实对周公成王的故事怎么从儒家的一种话语变成一种政治的一种叙述或政治的一种 修辞非常感兴趣，然后我再重新阅读这个周公成王，在妙泽老师的这个专著当中，不仅他从汉代文字史料来叙述这种故事，而且从文字史料怎么和物质文化或者从这种状物的这种表现的艺术史互相是怎么互动的，非常受启发。我自己呢，就是完全是作为一种就是学习的状态，想提出几个问题。第一个问题呢，我就觉得这个周公成王这个年龄，就是成王的年龄在妙泽老师的这个章节当中呢，进行了详细的叙述。就是在这个史料记载当中呢，成王有两个年龄，当他继承王位的时候，一个记载呢是说成王继承王位的时候呢，仅仅是一个婴儿，还在襁褓当中，就你必须要抱着他。而且这种历史叙述呢，是司马迁在《史记》上中提到，不仅司马迁在《史记》中提到，而且当霍光当蒲到这个昭帝的时候呢，史料当中，《史记》当中说呢，霍光实际上是得到了汉武帝的授权，汉武帝把霍光比作周公，然后汉武帝当时呢没有明确的在文字上表明，而是呢用一幅图片说你应该像图片一样，图片画的是什么呢？是周公背负成王，那成王就一定是婴儿状态。这就是这个史记当中的记述。但是在我们这个视觉系统当中呢，我们看到在东汉的时候呢，成王的表现呢都是一个小孩已经七岁或者是八岁，然后成王在这个整个视觉系统的艺术表现当中呢是在中间的位置。但是你看周公呢，他没有就是跟成王是有距离的。我想请教一下妙泽老师，就说在史记记载的曾经有的这种艺术表现，周公和成王的故事，为什么在我们就是说已有的周公和成王的故事当中，已经这种就是周公背负成王的这种形象彻底的消失掉了？就是是不是因为有没有什么猜测可以解释？这是第一个我自己非常感兴趣的。另外一个我比较感兴趣的呢，就是实际上是接着刚才大家的讨论，就是这个纹样性和状物性 ornamental 和这个 picture real 的这个一个转变。因为我其实在看这个书的时候呢，我看这个就是这个拓片，我就觉得很奇怪，就是说因为如果我们在读益州书王会篇，如果我们不用根据益州书王会篇我们自己要来画一幅图画的话，我们大概不会把它变成这种一行一行的来表现周公和成王的故事。那我们可能会画整个图就来表现，就是说整个图会是一个 square 来表现周公成王，但是我们看这个拓片呢，实际上它是用一行一行的来表现这个故事。是不是这种一行一行的 register 就反映了它有一个对纹样性这种艺术表现形式的一个继承？哦，不是，我就完全是想向妙泽老师请教，谢谢。
你说的那个关于成王两个年龄的问题呢，反正我觉得算书里也提到，是涉及到两个经学系统。那么认为成王死的时候，那个成王继位的时候是在襁褓，在襁褓也就是三岁以下吧，两岁等等。那么这是经文经的一个系统，不只是史记，史记其实是取的是经文经的立场，可能也就是一直以来流传的一个立场。所以这样他在襁褓呢就需要负，就是背，其实也未必是背背上，因为文字怎么理解不知道，反正表现的时候我觉得是无法背背上。那么画像石里边也有就是父子襁褓的那种形象，应该是一种抱着的这种样子。那么所以这是一个系统，也一直没有消失，在汉代包括东汉的文献里边谈到那个周公父成王的时候，大部分 都是说他是背着他，无论是抱着他还是背着他，这是最普遍的一种说法，在整个汉代经学里边。关于就是说成王继位的时候年龄是13或者14，这是古文经的一个说法。那么古文经我们知道啊，好，汉代的经学好多都消失了，只有一些片段。那么是大概是许慎的一些里边把这个给保留下来，说成王继位的时候是年龄13了还是14，忘了，14好像是14。那么这是古文经的一个说法。那么王莽继位的时候呢，在称那个周公的时候，他自称叫居舍，居舍的那一年呢，这时候平帝正好是14岁。那么其实很巧是吧，这个天下也不会有这么太巧的事情。那么如果14岁你要做画像的话，他一定就需要站着，就不能抱着。所以我觉得就山东的画像呢，应该来自于王莽这个系统。但是这个问题呢不是一个太大的问题，不是对王莽来说是一个大问题，对于那个武帝跟光武来说不是个大问题，不涉及到合法。虽然昭帝继位的时候是8岁，我记得是8岁是吧，他已经不再襁褓了，那么他仍然画了一个周公抱着成王的一个形象，其实就是一个比喻 metaphorically， 他不是。那么到了王莽这儿呢，他必须 literally，因为这个家伙往往就是这么一个人，他一切都要是要原教旨主义式的要跟历史对应起来，所以但他有这个需要。到了光武的时候呢，以及东汉呢，也没这个需要，因为不涉及政权的合法，只是一个 metaphor， 是一个 rhetoric， 一个修辞而已，所以只有在王莽这儿会牵扯的 legitimacy。 所以我觉得我认为就是这么，由于你确立了之后呢，那以前那个就大家没有人去在意了，就是一个 rhetoric 就好了。那么第二个问题是关于那个格子的问题。我觉得格子呢是跟一个套作有关的，就是说你如果表现一个内容，你当然可以就是简单去一个 single work，你可以做一个 square 的一个东西。假如是你是用不同的这个 motif， 不同的 subject matters 来组成一个有一个 program iconographic program， 那你就需要怎么把它们组织起来的问题。这样呢就是用各种格子，其实埃及也是这样，近东也是这样，他们这种用不同的主题来组成一个系统化的一个意识形态叙事的时候，他们就会考虑要涉及到怎么把它拼在一起的问题，所以他们就用这种格子 registers 来做。其实到了文艺复兴时期也还是这样的，就是你看文艺复兴那些教堂，比如说佛罗伦萨那个 Santa Maria 那个教堂里边，他讲到圣经的故事的时候也还是打这个格子，因为你如果把不同的主题拼在一起，你让它形成一个 program 的时候，你怎么组织呢？格子我觉得是最简单的，所以我想可能跟文样没什么关系。
谢谢啊，我可能需要翻译一下到英文，就是first it's my honor to be part of the panel to talk about the you know big work of Professor Miao Zhe。I really enjoyed reading it, both the literary merit and also the content. I said I really admire that Professor Miao Zhe exhausted all the available sources regarding certain topics. Also, his work examined the interaction between the textual tradition and the material cultures, how they could, you know, create some dynamics.So as intellectual historian of the early Chinese empires, I'm totally outsiders of art history. So I reading this book as a student and a post question and try to you know, learn more as a student. So my question actually concentrate on the story about Duke Zhou and the King Chen. So because it's a very famous story, advocated by Confucians, but later on followed by politicians. So they are, you know, make use of the historical anecdotes in the Zhou dynasty in order to legitimate the usurp of the throne, or either to legitimate, you know, the regent's exercise power, like Huo Guang, probably the first person, you know, start to use a story about Zhou Gong to justify his exercise of power under the reign of Emperor Zhao, who was only a boy. So my question is, you know, concentrated on the, you know, different narratives about the age of King Chen in the narratives. In, we have two different traditions. So one tradition talk about King Chen was only a baby holding, have to be held when he succeeded the throne. Another tradition talk about when King Chen succeeded the throne, he already 7 years old or maybe 13 years old. So there are some variations. Why I interested in this? Because I found in all the pictorial presentation, majority of them, the age of King Chen is about a boy could standing there in the center, and the Duke Zhou still, you know, occupy the position of minister. So never, so the pictorial presentation basically did not show that the Duke Zhou kind of, you know, take care of the, not only really become the center of the politics, never show the, he jian zuo, he becomes the king himself. So that's my question, the first question. Second one is I talk about, that's totally outsider question. I said, you can see all these stories, you know, represented about the Duke Zhou and Chen, they are registered 9 by 9. I'm wondering that kind of format, did that reflect the, you know, former discussion about from this kind of ornament, you know, ornament art translated to the pictorial art, did that, you know, affected or reflect the legacy of ornament art? Professor Miao Zhe, you know, tried to answer my question. He said, you know, this kind of tradition, you know, the narrative that, you know, the King Chen still a baby, still very popular in the Eastern Zhou Dynasty. Some of their art also represent the King Chen probably as a baby, definitely not carried by the Duke Zhou, but at least probably assisted by the Duke Zhou. So that, you know, still two traditions parallel with each other. Second question, Professor Miao Zhe answered properly, it's not necessary, not really influenced by the ornament, you know, tradition, how you have registered. Probably you try to tell a story or try to tell different parts of story, you use that format to represent. Also that could find the correspondence in Egyptian art or in the art of the, you know, Italian Renaissance period. Okay, thank you.
Great. Guolong, your turn.
Okay. 我先说那个，因为跟这个妙子很熟，所以他对他的著作也很熟。其实对他书的本体啊，我没有什么问题。就刚才我可以接，就是刚才接着那个刚才问话罗太这个提到的，就是说从这个学术史上来看呢。 就是庙子这个书啊，放在这么一个地位啊，然后我有一个那个很开放的一个问题，那个问他，就说那个悟鸿先生说这个武梁祠的研究有1000年的历史，当然从宋代的学者算起有1000年的历史，但是真正的对武梁祠的研究啊，从现代的研究还是30年代、40年代。 而且当时30年代、40年代这个武梁祠的研究啊的那个水平是很高的，这个门槛是很高的。你想有那个前面有那个沙婉啊，其他一些日本学者啊，这个就西方学者来开始研究武梁祠以来啊，对一些这个用形式分析 formalism 的一些方法来进行研究，这已经就是到30年代就比较成熟了。像那个藤谷在德国学了以后啊，他也开始用这个 这个形式分析的一些方法来研究这个。当然藤谷写的那个文章是关于南洋的那画像石，不是关于五梁祠的，但是关于五梁祠的这个研究的水平非常高，特别高的比如像劳干先生是 汉史专家，秦汉史，这个是那个滚瓜烂熟的那个专家，所以那个那时候的劳干，就刚才我提到这个问题，就是我们说从这个 ornamental art 到那个 decorative art， 从青铜器玉器到这个绘画这个转折的时候，在劳干的文章里面早已经说清楚。后来那个罗越跟吴洪先生跟后来的学者，就是这个指出来以后，大家都觉得这是一个很重要的问题，这个是一个很明显的问题，但是怎么解释这个是一个比较困难的问题。所以刚才说到了那个吴洪先生，当然是以做五梁祠那个这个第一本书。他在做五梁祠1989年吧出版以后啊，他开始想他第二个 project， 或者他已经开始讲他第二个这个计划的时候，他就写了很重要，就是一篇很大家很有名的文章，就是从庙到墓。虽然现在对这个从庙到墓这么这个转折，现在也有很多人批评，因为这个不完全是这个转折的关系。所以在那篇文章是1989年。在那个 Early China 上面发表的，他在最后的时候有一个很长的一个 note， 有一个附记，说啊，他现在在写一本书，是关于这个转折的，就是重新回到劳干这个问题上面去，然后他有一个方法。结果呢，这本书没有出来的是Monumentality 这个书，所以能看出来他的很多的这些的研究啊，他把它用一个新的框架，用这个Monumentality 这个概念把它框起来的，框在这些材料还是用这么一个转换的序列那个讲的，这个所以就这个问题是很难的一个问题。吴先生可能也想解决这个问题，有各种原因，我们也不清楚的原因，他就是这个最后的那个成果不一样，但我觉得妙哲这个是一个很好的解决，特别我这个。我觉得妙哲好的地方就是这个关于精益化这样的概念。这个我们现在就是说争论的时候啊，那个说那个 ornament 或者是说那个是纹样或者是再现或者状物，这个说已经什么时候是不是已经有了？这个在历史上，这个那个车轮是好几次被发明的，不是一次发明就结束的。就很多过程就是一次一次开始的，但是你要把它制度化社会化，这是一个另外的问题，这个在妙哲的理论结构里面思想里面也都说了这样的问题。所以呢，就是我在说这个汉画像研究这个历史啊，这个到了这个70年代末80年代以来，包括那个吴洪先生参加这个五梁祠的研究，像 Martin Powers 先生参加这个五梁祠，那时候由于中国的开放，中国考古发现了巨大的那个这个就是外国学者可以接受到中国这些材料了以后，所以那个是1995年，我到洛杉矶的时候啊，我看到的有一个书评，就是Jim James 跟 Martin Powers 先生有之间关于书评有一个讨论，这里面就是关于一些方法论的讨论。这个讨论就是我们在70年代跟80年代那个时候啊，有一个转向，就是把原来那些 formalist 的那个形式分析的那些东西啊，慢慢放淡，慢慢觉得那个有问题，有很多包括艺术史方面也有对一些这个形式分析的一些那个批评批判，所以那个大家的转向是转向这个社会历史分析跟这个情景分析，就是那个 social historical approach 跟这个 contextual approach， 这就是那个像吴洪的一些著作啊，代表了这么一种的那个在发展。所以这个 formalist 的这些东西啊，慢慢的就比较淡。所以我就劝那个妙哲，包括我跟他交往，我们了解他的东西，跟他就他现在能很好的把这两个结合起来，这个其实有从某种意义上来说也是西方传统跟这个中国传统吧，就是说你这种这个对史汉的熟悉，像 像我觉得像就罗泰他刚才提到前辈的那些西方学者那个巴霍芬啊，包括可能 Soper 那个 Alexander Soper 那个好一点，就是毕竟他们对中国的文献没有这么熟，没有像劳干他们，没有像妙哲那样熟，所以在这个形式分析跟这个社会历史分析之间结合的不是很好。所以我有一个那个就是一个开放的问题问妙哲，就是您是怎么处理，怎么把这两种这个结合起来？现在就非常看来这个东西的那个，就是你这个成果，这个出来的结果非常好，所以你是有一些什么想法？这我觉得对这个年轻的学者，包括学艺术史的学者是很好的一个。我说你这个书是那个给那个来者是鬼则的一个书，这是一个 model 一个这个，所以你讲一讲，这个是一个那开放的问题，随便你讲一讲。所以好，我那个把我的问题那个 summarize 一下 ，because I know Miao very well and he works very well. So looking at the history of study of Wu Liangci and the Han Dynasty pictorial art. There's a transition in the early period that many Western scholars and Chinese scholars are more focused on formal analysis, stylistic analysis. So in the late 70s and 80s, because of the self-reflection in art history, the methodological change in art history, so many of the Chinese art historians, also Western art historians who study Chinese art, gradually migrate to social-political contextual analysis of early Chinese art. So the formalist aspect was overlooked in many aspects. Certainly, I think Martin Power, you emphasized very much different style. But from Miao's analysis, like, you know, maybe that kind of, it's a, you know, formal analysis is a very, very useful, from Miao's work, we can see it's a very useful tool. But how to combine the formal analysis and contextual approach, and probably in other words, you know, the Western art historical tradition and more Chinese social historical approach, how to combine that? What kind of suggestion you have?
好。那个这个问题开放了有点大
，open question, open ended question，
知道怎么来回答。那个艺术史呢？我这本书其实写的看起来不像本艺术史，就是像一本思想史，里边有大量的关于汉代思想制度的，但是呢，
但你的问题是一个历史史实的问题，对不对？画像是哪里来的？来源是哪里？
对，但是我对于我们这个学科呢，有一个基本的一个信念，这个信念就是说，我们这个学科是关于形式的，是关于美学品质的，但是这个问题是如何让形式有意义 ，make form significant historically。如何让形式呢有历史的意义，认知的意义，形式之外的意义，不仅是形式的意义，就是说，我比较侧重的一点。那么，这当然就特别难，你知道吧？因为，其实。你从西方这个艺术史开始以来最难的也就是这个，从黑格尔建立他的体系，他所谓的从象征的到神话的，然后到古典的，到浪漫的，到潘诺夫斯基的所谓的 iconography， 其实都是在谈这个问题的，就是如何让形式产生形式之外的这种意义。我在好几个地方曾经说过，大家对 Panofsky 的那个 iconography 其实有一个不太准确的一个理解，老是认为就是说 认为这个 form 里边有一些信息等着我们去破解去 decipher。 其实呢，真正的 Panofsky 图像学的意义是说，这个观念是怎么 verbally and plastically 在词汇上以及跟塑形上来 figuration 来获得它的形态的。其实这是 archaeography 的一个最核心的问题，而不是反过来，就是说你有了形式，我们怎么来破解它的意义。所以这个是我的一个信仰，就是说我们做艺术史的形式一定是我们的一个最基本要考虑的，至于从哪个角度考虑是另一回事情。你是从形式的内部怎么发展，还是说这个形式体现了一种 Durkheim 所说的那个集体认知的一种 metamorphosis 的一种变形记呢？我觉得那是你个人的那种倾向的问题，但是形式一定是我们的中心。所以我这本书虽然形式出现的不多，但是我背后呢其实一直是有这个信仰。那么在这方面呢，我们说刚才提到 Martin Powers， 其实 Martin 呢，他其实我觉得这篇文他是最有抓的最牢的，你知道吧？他的那个关于 Early China 他的那个表现啊等等，还有他的 pattern 的 person 等等，其实他一直是试图让形式 how to make form you know significant historically， 怎么让形式有形式超越形式之上的意义。我觉得他一直在思考这个问题，但是他思考的方向也许你同意，也许你不同意，但是我觉得他抓住了我们这领域的核心，就是现在我们这领域好多时候就变成一个社会史的东西了，不关心形式，不关心品质，这跟我的信仰不一样。我在这方面我其实很赞赏 Martin， 虽然他的有些观点我可能不同意，包括我在书里也批评他，但是我觉得他抓住了我们这领域的核心，他一直努力的就是这个方向，如何让形式有形式之外的意义。所以
罗太也要加的。
哦，罗太。
I wait. Why don't you translate?
Oh, it's too complicated to translate. I think. So I think the essence of what Miao Zhe said is the combination of formal analysis and the historical contextual analysis should be combined. It's not you analyze looking at the form and then you try to find a meaning, rather you from inside. So I think that's exactly many of the problem of the early Western scholarship on Chinese, early Chinese art, their formal analysis. Oftentimes they borrow the Western evolution paradigm and try to impose onto the Chinese material. And I think Miao Zhe's approach is very, very much, you look at, we understand this, the internal social mechanism, then from there to sign meaning towards the result of formal analysis.
Lothar, do you want to comment?
Well, of course, there's a lot to say, but I would encourage taking a less binary approach to the matter and not sort of juxtapose the historical with the pure form, but do what Miao Zhe has done in this book, and which I think is the most significant part of it, namely pursue definition of the visual conventions that govern the expression of the outside world or the inner thinking of Han Dynasty individuals, and cause them to look like they are. That's what art history, in a strict sense, is all about. Not with identifying motifs, in fact, Miao Zhe just said that, but with how these motifs get expressed so as to unfold their meaning in a given cultural context. And this visual system has so far not really been reconstructed for the Han Dynasty. This is Miao Zhe's pioneering effort. Of course, there are prior attempts, and I would also single out Martin Powers' attempt as an extremely significant prior way of dealing with the issue. But here we have something that has become much more, I suppose, mature and also more comprehensive. What you should show, Tishu, Nishi, Lisha Wenxian, to take a Zhang Wu, her Wuji Wenhua, who to shoot your beauty, the Zhang Wu, Jian. 有很重要的一个第三者, 也就是说, 探索, 有关, 表现, 这些视觉的现象, 的, 这个在历史空间里面所发展的一些, conventions, 怎么说, 一个习俗, 就是视觉习俗和而且他们这些习俗的系统化这一点是反正妙智在他的书里面尤其比如说在他的有关建筑的两章里面做得非常成功的做得应该说是比前 前一辈的学者做得更有说服力。以前也可能没有这么宏观的有关就是理解汉代的这个世界系统的整体的这么一种目标性。 There's also, but one could illustrate this by the example that Liang Cai brought up, the representation of young King Cheng together with the Dukes of Zhou and of Shao. Why did they keep the visual formula that had arisen out of possibly political priorities during the Wangmang period, all the way through the Eastern Han period? I think the answer is probably because it was visually compelling and it had imposed itself on the visual consciousness of whatever the public was at the time. So there was no need, and it would probably have been counterproductive to resort to other versions of the motifs, even if there might have been doubts about the textual correctness of the representation. That at some level doesn't matter anymore.
Wait, do you want to respond or do we go to next? I think I'm the next one. So, I think the important angle to approach this book is agency, agency of art, which Professor Miao had an excellent translation, for which we probably would owe a great deal. I would use this in the future. Where when I was a student with Professor Martin Powers, the artistic agency rests in these local elites, like the Wuliang family, where they use these art system to voice their public kind of protest against the eunuchs in the court. And what Miao Zhe did is to remove agency from these local elite and place it to the grand political shift between the Han imperial power and Wang Mang's power based on his fairly specific understanding of Confucian classics. So there's a factional competition among high elites and different interpretation of classics. So by moving the agency up, these Wu Liangci as a kind of a derivative of imperial art, it demonstrated this grand scope of civilization and cosmology. Therefore, it accommodated all sorts of tensions and tried to introduce a coherent system. So you have things like Confucius meeting Laozi, a Duke of Zhou coaching King Cheng, and the Queen Mother of the West. That's all very enormous in scope. And then Liu Xiu inherited this tradition. And through his visit to Qu Fu, delivered or transferred this royal art to Lingguang Palace. And then Liu Qiang, the crown prince, the former crown prince, inherited that. So once those imperial, those royal art disappears, so the Wuliang shrine, this kind of a local derivative, would be the surviving pieces to allow us to investigate what the royal art should be. I really much like this idea, but my question is, why Lu state is has this extraordinary privilege? As Professor Miao said, that this Lu state, it was the land, the state granted to Duke of Zhou. So that's the regent to King Cheng. So even in the Zhou period, it enjoyed high privilege, like a royal, like the son of heaven, which is very different from other feudal lords. And then this became the script for these Han performances. So as we know, the Duke of Zhou really personified the tradition of creating the ritual system. The sumptuary rules is based on rank, hierarchy, and order, which is exclusive. That's why Lu state is exclusive compared to other kings. And you violate that in Han time, there are serious consequences. So my question would be, if this royal art can sink, infiltrate the countryside of the Lu state in the Han period, yet this art is so important that it was off the limit to other Han elite. How could this work out? And if the local elite can appropriate this royal art and its grand schemes of cosmology and the imperial ideology, then are they really the kind of passive consumers of royal art, or this appropriation already gave them a new kind of agency? As Professor Martin Powers stated out, that by having this art, by displaying art like this in public space, you are making a statement. So I was interested in this Dongyuan, Ta Nei Zai De Zhe Zhong Li Liang. 当鲁国的乡间的这些个人，就中低层阶级的人，已经可以拿到灵光殿的皇家艺术的情况下，那这个他们到底是只是仰慕皇家艺术的消费者，还是说当他得到这个的时候，已经得到了一种新的政治表达的一种途径？
OK,
that's my question.
那个谢谢黎明。关于第一个问题呢，就是皇家的艺术是怎么跨越这种理智的这种 limitation， 然后能够被 appropriated， 那个被下层来挪用的。其实呢，我们不知道，因为我在书里边以及著里边也谈到这些。我们可以只能想象一个渠道是怎么来的。比如说我里边讲，就是刘强跟刘仓的陵墓修建的时候，皇帝只是派来了那个设计师 designer 将作室。那么设计师是不足以造陵寝的，所以一定是从附近来征发这个工匠来。那么这样就为我们理解这种本子是怎么流传下去的，然后有一个线索可以去想象一下。那么至于说这个理智的阶层怎么跨越的，我想呢，我自己的想法，当然我其实我书里不是 focus on 这个问题上的，我就粗粗的想，我自己的想法是，当你从皇帝的一套这个艺术制作被家里给诸侯王的时候，其实他已经没那么严肃了，就你并不是抄的皇帝的，你是抄的是诸侯王的。
但是其他的诸侯王可不可以派一些个考察队到鲁国来说，我也想抄一些这些皇家的东西，这不就是僭越了吗？
这就是另一个问题，就是说首先我们就是说，你等你抄诸侯王的时候，其实呢这个问题就不那么严重。那么第二个问题呢，就是说看谁抄，对吧？如果你是个老百姓抄，你造了一个，我们知道汉代的祠堂很小，大的像孝堂山呢也就4米长而已，五梁祠就2米宽的样子。假如你是个诸侯王，像你刚才说的，你是个诸侯王，你是个首相，你来抄这个，其实你也不需要从诸侯王里面抄，你能得到这个本子的，那这个性质不一样，因为你有更大的这种能力，动量的力量能够想这种谋反呀，或者这样的事情。所以第一就是说变成诸侯王之后不那么严重，第二需要看谁抄。那么第三个问题呢，是一个现象，历史现象，就我们能看到实际上目前我们发现的五梁祠派的这套画像呢，很少有在鲁国的，很少有在那个东海国的，也很少有在这个东平国的，目前都集中在山阳郡，它是紧挨着鲁国的。然后孝堂山祠还有跟它相似的这类画像呢，是在当时的泰山郡。我不知道这个分布呢能不能说明什么情况，就是说你在鲁国其实很少能发现这样的东西。是不是就是说这个地方王家有更多的这种 surveillance 等等会发生问题，我们不知道。但那么
曹操墓是有的，所以这个这也是很有趣的一点。
对，曹操墓我觉得它一定不是来自于民间的，应该是它有一个流传的本子，就是上层流传的一个本子。那么第二个问题就是说，这个皇家的这一套东西呢，是不是中下层怎么用的问题？
对，就是他得到了皇家的东西以后，是给他带来在政治表现方面有一个什么样的新的潜力？
对，我在书里边呢称之为内化 internalization， 你如何把它内化到你自己的这个社会这个 context 里边。那么我这本书其实一本书总是目的总是有限的，你做什么跟不做什么你要有一个选择。我这本书主动不做的呢，就是不做这一步，不做这个 internalization， 因为不是就像你说的把这个 agency 往上移 moving 啊，那个
我再给你拽回来。
对，不是往下
and coming down。
以后的学者可以做，年轻学者可是一个题目啊。
大家有兴趣可以做，但是我觉得呢，我自己这么感觉，从社会学的角度我们来想，对吧？我们不具体的从五梁祠来看，从社会学角度来想，一般的来说， 社会中下层精英呢是更加的认同主流的意识形态的。所以说他们在接纳这个
没有问题，关键就是这东西到了他们手里的时候，当独属于赵家的东西现在到了这个当地的这些个知识群体手里，他会有什么样的政治的潜能。但是我们时间不多了，我应该让给后边的两位教授，所以我简单的翻译一下，我们可以继续讨论将来。So the short answer is he hasn't really looked into this, and maybe if other kings try to appropriate this special privilege that the Lu state enjoyed, then there are serious political consequences. But if it's local people, they appropriate this in small scale, maybe less so. But the political potential of having this agency through appropriating royal art, he hasn't worked on this. So future scholars can approach. So now let's move to Professor Li Huishu of art history.
首先我要恭喜那个妙哲，写了这么大一部书啊，是怎么讲，气势恢宏，学贯中西，博大精深，发人深省。那
Only physically monumental.
First, I want to congratulate the Professor Miao Zhe, you know, for the milestone publication. And of course, I think it's something hard to follow his footstep. It's because the scale and the breadth, and so on one hand I extremely admire, but I thought it was also very interesting because he actually have a section particularly mention how art historian has been working on this subject, but also these art historian also receive very severe criticism from Professor Miao. 我自己先总结一下哈，就是我觉得很有意思，因为妙哲教授在书里面提到，就是说艺术史家事实上对汉朝画像史研究是有所建树贡献的，但是也遭受到妙哲教授很严厉的批评。那这也正是我觉得妙哲教授这本著作突破的地方。所以我就不再多褒扬他，那个我因为其他后面发言有很多好处，我想说的其实很多刚刚有同行同事们都提到了，所以我有基本上我有两个反思看了你的这部著作，然后也有两个提问。So I'm going to focus on two of my reflections and two inquiries. 那这两个反思呢，其实是三个方面，一个是性别问题，一个是就是这个 agency 你说的这个动员的问题，第三个就是文本的问题。那文本问题其实慧君刚刚也提了一些，那那个什么动员问题李明教授提的，所以我想是说我先讲这个性别问题。我觉得您的这一章王政君跟西王母对我来讲是特别有启发，因为我在做性别问题的时候，我发现我真希望你这个早一点写。我在写武则天啊或什么时候，我现在才知道就是中国的学问这个一脉相传，那个有很多是要追溯到更早的。所以这个很多关于西王母的问题，还有这个就是女主的问题，在这个王莽的时代，你这个条分理序要这个脉络这么清楚楚的排比，我发现非常的这个怎么讲，我很幸福。但是我同时也在想到这个问题，就是这个英文里我们讨论这个 subjectivity 的问题，就是这个主体性的问题。我发现这个王政君 根据你的书写是完全是非常被动的，这个动员全部是来自于王猛。但是我又想起王政君的时代，这个汉代有很多女主，从吕后邓皇后，然后到这个王政君，这个还有这王政君的时代也是刘向写《列女传》的时代，《列女传》成书大概在公元20年左右。然后呢这个都是成帝的时代，成帝是王政君的儿子。那成帝时代也是赵飞燕、赵氏姐姊妹还有班婕妤的时代。所以我发现这个就说这个性别问题在这个时代好像都交结在一起。那因为我对文本的分析，我觉得这个刘向写《列女传》或像后来张华做的《女史箴》，我的书里面也提到了，我的看法是跟一般就是说所谓正统男性学者的书写我意见非常不一样。我觉得这个成书在譬如说王政君时代，或者是张华写《女史箴》是在那个贾太后、贾南风时代，那个或者是武则天时代再度的搬就是说重新印行扩大这个所谓女界的书写。所以我觉得这是女主在自我宣扬、自我表达的一个方式。所以也就是说我觉得你写的这一章当然让我觉得这个大开眼界，但是也激发我同时去想到这个性别跟这个动员的问题其实是可以有很多层次的，因为他们同时发生在一个时代。这是我的一个想法。第二个就是关于这个文本的问题啊，我读你分析这个灵光殿赋，那因为我个人对中国园林的问题非常有兴趣，一直在教授这门课。那你对灵光殿赋的分析跟解读啊，让我想起汉武帝时代司马相如的《上林赋》，所以我觉得这个给我提供一个将来我在写这个园林的书啊，就讲到这个设计方案或主题构成，当然就说然后这要牵涉我下一个等一下要问的两个问题啊，那我就自己先总结一下用英文呢。Say my I have two reflections from reading Professor Miao Zhe's book. One particularly with the issue of gender interconnected to agency, particularly the chapter on Queen Mother of the West.And the Wang Zhengjun, you know, the empress dowager, you know, preside over the political arena for over 61 years actually altogether. So in Miao Zhe's writing, you know, Wang Mang loomed really big. You know, he really the center, the nexus, you know, the agents of the shaping up and also later implementation or dissemination of the image of the Queen Mother of the West. But meanwhile, this is also a time Liu Xiang, who composed the 列女传, biography of eminent women in the year of 20 AD. It's also the time under Emperor Cheng, one of the most famous femme fatale, Zhao Fei Yan, and also the most virtuous lady. This all been written into Liu Xiang's 列女传, Ban Jie Yu. So I was thinking, you know, this didactic writing, aiming at a woman, often, you know, was under, you know, I think also a different kind of agency under the female ruler.So I don't see Wang Zhengjun as just a passive figure. This is all Wang Meng's doing. I'm actually curious whether this her involvement to what degree, because the fact that Liu Xiang I think it's under, you know, certain kind of patronage, whatever, you know, under Wang Zhengjun. And this is actually a kind of pattern, like in Zhang Hua's time, the admonition, you know, written by Zhang Hua, or in Wu Zetian's time, so on and so forth. So that's one of my reflections. The second reflection is about the how to use light text. So from the rhapsody on the luminous brilliance, Lingguang Dian, I thought about the Shima Xiang Ru She rhapsody on the supreme forest or the imperial park of Han Wu Di. So thank you, Miao Zhe, and I think a lot, you know, and welcome to, you know, open up the question. But I have a two question for Miao Zhe. I know we are running out of time, but you know, maybe for the future, it's as an art historian, I read the book. Of course, now we don't know how to define what art history, what's art history writing, right? Because the scholarship, you know, so many interdisciplinary, you know. I know this is a book, but I, you know, because between the visual material, images and text. Visual material, the other day in Jinan touched upon something, you know, that's another, you know, kind of detail issue. But I want to challenge the Miao Zhe. Even you keep reiterating that you took the visual things, you know, seriously. But somehow I still don't feel, you know, 就是你的图是在主位。 我觉得是文在主位, because I don't get the whole comprehensive, you know, picture of the your grasp of overall visual material. So I learned about, you know, this very powerful argument from the way you construct it and, you know, utilize all kind of textual, including a lot of, you know, that is so profound. So this is one of my questions. And then second is the, if we have any time, I try to kind of understand the structure of your book, 就是这个布局结构的问题. Now, if we have time, I you know, hope that you can kind of share your insight. Because a lot of coming from, or overlap with some of the article you published before. 所以你以前的论文，所以当然有人会批评说，这个也像个论文集，加了序言，然后中间有一个核心思想把它串联起来。所以我很好奇，就是你的思维，在这个对于这个书的布局跟结构，还有个整体性，the internal logic.
谢谢回总。 我回应一下性别的问题，性别的问题，我意识到了，但是因为我是个男性，有时候对性别的感觉不那么强，就很抱歉的事。那么汉代的性别呢，应该跟它的阴阳是有关的，因为它要把这个人伦结构定义为一个阴阳的一个 reflection， 就这样对皇后的地位就重新做了一个定义，这就是给它一个 conceptualization， 所以这是很重要的一件事儿。那么导致汉代的这种皇后，尤其太后权力特别的大，所以这是一个回应吧。那么关于这俩问题呢，就是确实是这本书是文在主位的，也跟我的整个那个三本书的分布有关。第一本书我主要是谈图像学，其实。 第二本书就会谈形式，所以第二本书的标题叫《汉代的奇迹》（The Milk of Han Dynasty）。那么主要谈艺术的形式，还有它体现在其他知识构建方面的形式，包括你怎么论辩 （disputers 那些人用的那些论辩的形式），还有那个文学的形式等等。所以第二本是专门谈形式的。 所以第一本确实有这样的，所以我说它不像一本艺术史书， 像一本思想史，利用视觉材料来做思想史。那么第二个问题呢，就是这个论文集，对，是这样，因为在美国写书呢，大家比较重视一个 narrative， 然后各章之间要比较各种关节之间这个 jumps 之间呢要很好的连接起来。那么在中国写书，大陆中文写书呢，其实大家好像也不太要求这个，可能不太友好，对纯读者不太友好，这样就留下了大量的lacunas， 然后需要有点专业知识的人去填补它去。所以我这是一本中文语境里产生的书，就是不是一本按照西方的那种特别流畅的 narrative 写的书，有这个缺点，所以读起来有时候会有一些难。
Should I translate it? Because we're running out of time.
It's okay. We can go over a little bit. Yeah.
Okay.
Brief
translation. 妙哲老师回应就是说，是的，性别问题在in English. Okay. Yeah. The gender issue is critical in the Han time. 这个阴阳 you know, notion. This is the definitive. Era.So, but you know, it's not his area specialty, but he did acknowledge it. And then secondly, is the, what was my question? Oh, this book more is like intellectual history, and was more his thinking within more Chinese writings, in kind of logic.So not so much of the English publication. We always think of a singular kind of narrative to connect it in terms of the structure of the book. And so I also challenged him about the he seems way more for art historian.It seems, on one hand, extremely admirable, but on the other hand, seems not satisfied because I feel the visual material is still kind of placed in a secondary, place. And he somehow acknowledged it, but the next book, that will be the focus.
Great. Thank you, Hui Shu. Before we turn to Lothar for...his own kind of a comment and a concluding remark. Would the panelists have anything to add? A follow-up question or further elaboration? I know we must have a lot of questions from the audience, but since we're running out of time, if you don't have any questions, well, let's move to Professor von Falkenhausen.For kind of an overview of this project that spanning 10 years with UCLA connection.
Don't hold your hopes up. It's 4:07 a.m. where I am, so I'm barely coherent. In any case, many important things have already been expressed.Maybe as a way of complementing what I said earlier about the very important need to have a conceptual process in between linking visual systems to textual evidence. Of course, the same is true about literary evidence, and I think this is not often understood, that you cannot simply assume that the kind of fabulous world represented in the Han Dynasty rhapsodies is going to be, first of all, ever existed in real life, but also you cannot assume that there's any visual representation that directly renders that. So there are linkages there are textual conventions, inherent in the literary genres, which must be understood and taken into account. In fact, Professor Michael Nyland pointed this out when she critiqued Wu Hong's book. And she was right. This is complicated, and I would still give a little more credit to MIAO Zhe for having made a significant contribution to art history than he seems to be willing to do himself. This is not just a book centered on intellectual history, or if it is, the intellectual history is very substantially written through not only the visual evidence, but the reconstruction of the kinds of conceptual processes that went into the generation of the visual evidence. That's a very major progress, which hasn't previously been accomplished. And yes, of course, the introduction of lots of textual material is necessary in this process. That is no doubt, but that doesn't make it, in that sense, a textual work. But we do look forward to the coming volumes, where the art historical components will be even more pronounced, and which then will also put all this into its proper perspectives. Finally, I really hope that this book will find an English translator that can match the stylistic elegance of the Chinese original. That would have to be a native speaker, a native writer of English, and a very accomplished one for that. But this is certainly a book that should be translated into many languages, and I hope it won't take too long. Having waited for 11 years until my book was finally translated into English, into Chinese rather, I hope that that MIAO Zhe will get his out in English earlier. But don't try to translate it yourself. It's not advised for a non-native writer to translate into a language that isn't the native language. So with this, I would give the podium back to Li Min for some truly concluding remarks. But thank you and congratulations again.
Yes. Congratulations. Thank you, Lothar, for this very encouraging comment. We all share that kind of aspiration. And thank you, every panelist, for joining this very exciting discussion. And thank you for Esther, to accommodate us during your travels, and the support of Center of Chinese Studies, and also the publisher, Hantang Yangguang. And so we look forward to the next two volumes from Professor MIAO Zhe. All the best.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Go back to sleep, Lothar.
Yes. Okay. Good morning. Good night.
No, please. Okay.
Bye.
Okay. Bye.